So this is what I was mentioning. This is kind of the way this, you guys didn't think you'd get out of here with any math, right? A little math, actually. This is just visual math. So the way this works is Q is representative flow. We use that. And T is time, okay? And so the what's happening here is we get a rainstorm that happens, and then we get that water to collect. Like I said before, if it's undeveloped, maybe it ponds a little bit on the surface. If it's a good soil, not a clay soil, it might soak into the soil and eventually reach groundwater. And so it takes a little time for the water to actually start running off. And when we do get runoff, it tends to be less because we have that infiltrating or we have, you know, it's going across grass, et cetera, or prairie land. And so our pre-development conditions kind of look like this. Well, once we develop it, it tends to look like this. And so what happens is, as I had mentioned before, is it gets we develop these, so they're very efficient. The water, the rain comes down, lands, gets it right off, and so we get this really peaky kind of profile like that. And so the water's just, you know, hauling off there, and that causes all kinds of problems that I had mentioned before. We also get a lot more volume because we don't have any water, any place for that water to go, and so. So this is kind of the profile, and this is what we're actually, when we design our BMPs, we're often designing to try to make this top get more towards this. Okay, so these are some of the effects of development. Kind of hit a lot of those already. We're also, by the way, decreasing base flows to our streams. So what happens a lot of times when we don't have that development, and I mentioned the soil or the water going into the soil, it takes some time and slowly, maybe over days or weeks, gets to our streams. And so that's called our base flow in our streams. And so we're actually reducing our stream flow during those inner event periods by having that development because the water can't get in there and slowly make its way back to the streams. And that has all kinds of other effects as well. So. I've got the map again of the Federal Center here, and it's really hard to see on this, but if you look close, there's some green lines that go here and there. I'll step up here so you can see them. So we have some green lines, and I should probably change this figure so they're a different color. These are the stormwater pipes, and also on there, there's little dots that represent the stormwater inlets. Okay, why is it important for you guys to know where the stormwater inlets are? Protect them. Because we're not saying that you can't develop. We're not saying that you can't dig. You can't do all this stuff. It's just there needs to be a procedure to follow. And we need to be able to protect those in case all of a sudden we do get a cloud burst and we get a whole bunch of rain that we weren't anticipating. Even if we are anticipating it, we need to be able to protect those inlets. And so having an idea of where those inlets are compared to where you're working is good to do. So this is just some examples of different runoff pollution. I had mentioned that algae building up from nutrients. You can see that in the lower right-hand picture there. That's actually a blue-green algae. It actually becomes toxic. So not a good thing to have in your lake. Some more algae up above. Some of these others are just showing scour, et cetera. So we'll talk about some construction and post-construction stormwater management. So I don't know if you guys can actually read those cartoons, but the one on the right is a cartoon showing Bart saying, "Don't work, it's gonna be cool." Homer's on the job, man. Oh, it's like you recognized him as some of your employees. No finger pointing. But on the other side are geeks like me. Planning, design, and engineering, it says underneath, and it has these guys. He says, "I did nothing today, and I still got paid." What? Nobody can relate? That's the nerds. Yeah, that's right. Those are the people that are nicely dressed and with the ties on. No, but it really does take all of us to work on this together to be able to resolve some of this stuff. So construction site runoff, the biggest one is looking at erosion and your exposed surfaces, whether it's a pile of dirt, or it's that hole, or it's that water that's in that hole that you're dewatering and where you're putting it to. So that's a big part of it. Post-construction stormwater controls, that we're looking at trying to control the runoff from, for instance, the parking lots or rooftops or other locations to try to treat it before it gets to our waterways. So really the goal for the construction program, of course, is to prevent or minimize the impacts of construction, minimize erosion, and consider post-construction stormwater management. Oftentimes, that phase between the construction and the post-construction BMPs, a lot of times you're reusing ponds or reusing some locations. A lot of times the practices are very different. And a lot of times there's not a real good connection between the two, where you're not necessarily thinking about, well, let's see, I'm protecting this inlet with this these rock socks at this time, and then what am I going to do afterwards for my post-construction? So sometimes it's a little bit different problem, and sometimes even those are the redesign plans. Sometimes the design plans are very different and hard to know what, okay, the engineer specified this. Well, that material doesn't exist, so we have to do material substitution. Is this one okay? Is it not? So there's a lot of that kind of stuff that happens with those kinds of plans. One thing I wanted to hit on this general construction permit, because this is sometimes confusing. To get the permit, you actually have to disturb one or more acres. Okay. Now, that doesn't mean that we're not doing erosion sediment control on anything that's smaller than 1 acre. We are. We just have to go out and get a special permit when it's greater than 1 acre. So the other thing I wanted to point out real quick on this is that all projects on DFC require dig permits if the ground is breached, if you're getting in the ground. And that's because of some of our special situations here, our legacy of this site. When I started reading about some of this, I was impressed by the history that was here at the DFC. Anybody know about some of that history? Anybody into guns? Remington? Huh?
Remington Arms.
Remington Arms, right, was housed here. What did they make here?
Ammunition.
What specifically? They had one of the best shells here, or one
30 caliber
and 30-06. They produced the best material here, and that's pretty impressive. So you know, there's some really neat history here, but along with some of that industry, there's a lot of legacy of that, and then others that were here in between. So I think it's really, really fascinating, but that also presents another issue that we have to think about whenever we're digging in the ground. Is there some of that stuff still there? Do we have that asbestos that was wrapping some of the pipes and so forth in the ground? So we have to start thinking about that kind of stuff every time we dig. Okay, so these are some of the things that Bill and I, in terms of looking at the stormwater management plan, are looking at to kind of protect the site for construction runoff, to protect it from everything, but specifically construction runoff, using contract language that often funnels down to you guys. It says, look, you know, we need to report this stuff. We need to, we have these dig permits, et cetera. So that's one of the ways that we're able to kind of to control that. The waste control, how it's disposed of, the material, where it goes, the erosion sediment control that you guys are already doing, and know about construction site inspection forms. So we have inspections to go out there and say, yeah, you guys are looking pretty good, or, oh, we could improve on this place or this place. And this is just a list of a bunch of different erosion sediment control types of BMPs, those best management practices. I'm not going to go through a bunch of these. You guys are probably quite familiar with them, for those that are especially doing the contracting. Some of these are really cool, and they're evolving almost daily in terms of the practice. And some we've had around for a long time and know their effectiveness pretty well.